The following is a Hoop Ball presentation.
Welcome to another edition of the Hoop Ball Sacramento Kings podcast. I'm your host, Christian Villere. You can find me on Twitter at MyBuddyChris. For all of Hoop Ball Sacramento Kings coverage on Twitter, it's at Hoop Ball Kings. And for all of your NBA news, NBA fantasy news, and Sacramento Kings coverage, period, it's hoop-ball.com. Get the season pass now if you're playing fantasy basketball. It is a must-have. It gets you access to all the premium content that HoopBall puts out. If you're a new user to DraftKings and deposit $10 there, gets you the season pass for free. Quite the deal. HoopBall is now sponsored by Hawaiian Isles, Kona Coffee Company. Go to HawaiianIsles.com or search Hawaiian Isles Kona Coffee on Amazon to get some of their fine product. You can also follow them on Twitter at HI Kona Coffee. And if you participate in one of the daily, or I should say weekly, content fantasy contests that HoopBall puts on, and you win or place, you could get some Hawaiian Isles Kona Coffee. So if you're interested in trying the product, enter one of those contests. It's only $3 to enter. Give that a try. You can find this show on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, Google Play, as well as the iHeartRadio and HoopBall Radio apps, which are available for free to download in the iTunes and Google Play store. On this episode of the podcast, we have Sacramento Kings beat blogger for HoopBall, Mr. John Schifferle. He and I get into the last two ball games for the Sacramento Kings, and then it's trade deadline season, which means we went into part two of prospects that we think the Kings could target in a trade. They don't have their draft pick. Teams are not giving up draft picks anymore. It's got to be the sort of D'Angelo Russell model, a la what the Nets did with taking on a salary and getting a promising young player in return. With that model in mind, we looked at a couple possibilities for the Sacramento Kings. Enjoy this episode of the HoopBall Sacramento Kings podcast. He is back with us yet again, Sacramento Kings beat blogger for HoopBall, Mr. John Schifferle. How are you, sir?
Doing good. Having a good night. How are you?
I'm doing very well. My internet connection seems to be a little bit spotty, so if there's something audio-wise that seems amiss at some point during this podcast, you will now know why. Getting into the goings-on with the Sacramento Kings, they played two games recently against the Nets on Monday in Brooklyn and against the Raptors in Toronto on Tuesday. Two games we expected them to lose. We said that on this podcast. Against the Nets, there were a couple things that I took away in particular. The Nets just had the best player on the court in D'Angelo Russell. The man could not miss if his life depended on it. They really ratcheted up the defensive pressure in the second half. They looked like the team who wanted the game, the team who was headed to the playoffs, who was actually in the playoffs if they were to start today. And the Kings looked like they were in the middle of a road trip, playing at a time that they're not used to. Their body clocks were off, and their play followed. They just could not make shots. Defending the paint and providing that consistent pressure for the Kings still seems to be a sticking point for them. How can they be defensively minded and play good defense without fouling? That is something that young teams struggle with and they're still learning to do. And Bielitsa, no minutes in the second half. I was a little confounded by that. Anytime he's not getting big minutes, I don't quite understand it. I would like to see him play more. Yes, there's been this charge for Marvin Bagley to start, especially now with him playing so well yesterday against the Raptors and him putting up a nice stat line. I think he's very good where he is. I think he's developing on a nice path. I don't think it needs to be rushed by any means, or that taking minutes away from Bielitsa is going to somehow get the Kings to where they want to be any faster. He did not play at all against the Raptors. And since John did not watch that game against the Nets, but he does have something that he wants to share with me,
to get my take on. So we'll go ahead and pivot to that right now. What do you got for me, John?
Oh, I don't have something. I have a few things.
Oh, good. Well, that's what I'm here for.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't see the game, but the box score is really all I need to let out some really hot takes. But I didn't understand Shumpert playing the second most minutes on the team when he was 1-for-10. And on some level, he somehow played more than Justin Jackson, who had 14 points on 8 shots. And it felt like as I was following along in the little play-by-play in the app because I was at work, like, Justin Jackson couldn't miss, and he wasn't really out there taking many shots, but anytime they actually got him shots, he seemed to hit them. And I've seen Justin Jackson play in those games, and it truly is just one of those scenarios where it doesn't seem like he can miss the shots he gets. He has those once a month, and I don't know. I think in those games, especially if Shumpert's going to struggle that much, maybe he just needs to be playing, you know, as many minutes as possible and just even running plays for him at that point.
I think it had to do with the fact that it's a young team, still not adjusting to when somebody has the hot hand, making it a little easier to get them the ball, having that player establish themselves and get to the ball. With Amon Shumpert in particular, he did not play the next day. He's not playing the second night of back-to-backs. That might have had something to do with it. Jaeger might have been making a statement where they aren't able to stop people on defense. They weren't able to stop the Nets. He figures he wants to have one of his better defenders out there. He might have also been thinking, Shumpert's really not the guy that's hurting me here, and I want him out there for defensive purposes. He's not going to be playing tomorrow night. I might as well get out of him what I can now, since we're not able to stop anybody. That would be my assessment as to why he is the one playing the most minutes in a game at a weird time on the first night of a back-to-back.
So I get that Shump plays hard and he gives a lot of effort. I don't like him that much defensively. I think he gets beat a lot, and I think being a little too aggressive can get him in trouble. And I don't even know that I like him much better than Justin Jackson at this point. I think they're just different. Like, Jackson does a lot of things. I mean, I don't even know if does a lot of things is the right way to say it. He's just frankly a lot taller and has longer arms. And that in and of itself is a benefit for your starting small forward or any small forward you're going to put out there. And I think gets himself in trouble less often. Like, he doesn't take himself out of plays by gambling for something nearly as often as Shumpert does. And so I'll say to the other side of that, he also doesn't really generate nearly as many steals and blocks and all that. So I think Shumpert's more of a playmaker defensively. Jackson is a guy that's going to fit in a little bit more and just not really hurt you. And I don't see any reason to keep him out there for defense unless you really feel like you need a playmaker out there.
Also, One more thing I want to add. Jaeger seems to disengage a little bit from the rotations when the score gets expanded one way or the other. Actually, yeah. In the second half, when they are in a 10 or 20 point, not a, shouldn't say a 10 point hole, but when it's looking bad for them and it's trending closer to 20 than it is to 10, he seems to be disengaged a little bit from the rotation. He seems, I don't know what else he could be. I mean, I'm guessing he's thinking about other things, but it doesn't seem like he's fully there with deciding when exactly to pull somebody out. I would have liked to have had Buddy in there a little bit more in the second half. Let's see what he can do. Try to get him the ball some more, run him off of some more screens. But c'est la vie. And I just, from the way that game was going, I highly doubt they were going to have any chance of coming back, regardless of who he played. That is a much better team than the Pistons. They will be in the playoffs, and they are going to be a tough first round out for sure.
Yeah, and I can't really speak to any play-by-play stuff in terms of, you know, when he did or didn't move guys in and out of the lineup and all that. But yeah, I don't know. I just, that really stuck out to me. And I, even when I was watching the play-by-play stuff, it seemed like early in the third quarter, Shumpert had, you know, quite a few missed shots, turned the ball over, just seemed to kind of put them behind and set the tone for a bad second half. And I don't know that it's his fault, but he's not even shooting 30% this month right now. I mean, maybe he just needed the rest that he got in Toronto, but yeah, he's not been playing well.
Probably reverting back to the mean, which we discuss all the time. Let's get to the game against the Raptors the following evening. Nothing much in particular stuck out to me with this one. A lot of guys out for both teams. Harry Giles, I want to talk about him because we talked about his effect on Willie Cauley-Stein a couple games ago. It seems like he is now having the same effect on Kostas Koufos. We saw Koufos for the first time in a while. He was active on both ends of the floor, even got off his feet to block a shot, which we haven't seen a whole heck of a lot of. He was playing with some effort. Clearly, he wanted those minutes. He wanted to show that he was ready and able to perform when called upon. Giles, on the other hand, is looking out of shape. I can't justify why he would be looking gassed. He sat out all of last year when his knees were fine, which means he had plenty of time to get in shape. He had all of the summertime, training camp, beginning of the season. He's been playing now for a good bit of time. There's really no reason to be out of shape. And he is. He's sucking wind like crazy. Far more than Marvin Bagley Jr. It's concerning, and it's probably a big reason why he is out of position far more often than not on defense. Have you seen something? What are you seeing from Giles in this respect?
I'm not as concerned with it, and I do think, honestly, part of it is just there was such a long stretch of time where he was not playing basketball, and the Kings tried to play really fast. And Bagley did miss some time in there, but at his worst, what was he playing? Like 10, 15 minutes a game? Like that was
no. He was minimum. He was sitting. He was sitting out entire games. But
Bagley?
No. You're talking about Bagley. I thought you were talking about Giles.
Yeah, I was talking about just Bagley. In contrast, has never really fallen out of the rotation, and that means every time they play, he's getting up. And I do get that he missed time, but you know, I don't know. Bagley's a phenomenal athlete. He hasn't really sat out for the lengthy stretches that Giles has, and you know, I think it's just catching up to him. And I would say he didn't play last year. That was a whole year he wasn't playing, you know, full NBA action and wasn't, you know, adjusting as far as, you know, cardio is concerned. So I think that's probably a large part of it. I don't know. I think he'll probably not have that problem next year.
Hopefully. That doesn't have anything to do. Well, I guess it has. Of course, it has something to do with it. But having all this time to get in the kind of cardiovascular condition that you need in order to run up and down the court is like the first box you need to check so that you can be an effective basketball player. And it's not there. He's playing well. He's eager to get the ball at the elbow so that he can make plays from there, and that's his strength. But on defense, it's happening far too frequently where players are moving one way and he is far too late to react to it, which is concerning to me because it either means his defensive IQ is not that high. I think it's probably higher than that type of play lets on, or he's viciously out of shape and needs to do something about it to get his cardio up. That needs to happen ASAP. I will be looking at that throughout the rest of the season. And if he's continuing to look as ragged late in the season as he is right now, that will be a concern for me heading into the summertime and into next season.
Yeah, I've always seen the defensive stuff more as just the game. Like, he's very good about, like, paying attention off ball and trying to see where he should be at. And I think he tries really hard to be aware of everything going on around him. And I think that gets him in trouble a lot because he can take his eyes off of the person that he's guarding for just a little bit too long or just not quite be paying the right amount of attention to them. So I've always interpreted it a little bit more that way. And it will be interesting to see because he's going to probably get some pretty good run here up until the All-Star break and then have a nice, you know, few days off to try and get, I don't know, rested. So that should be good. And we'll see how he reacts after that. But that's just sometimes this time of the season for rookies. I think it's just going to happen a little bit. And I think next year is more important for me.
I want to see the Kings come out against one of these next two teams that they're playing on the road. They're playing Memphis in Memphis on Friday and at the Clippers on Sunday, which is going to be tough because I think that's another – that's a noon start. No, it's a 12:30 start. Good old 12:30 Sunday start. Maybe they'll pull off what they did 2 years ago with Buddy Hield making a ridiculous comeback in the fourth quarter.
Well, they really need to win that game, and Memphis hasn't been good, so they should win that. What did you think about Bagley against Toronto?
Bagley looked really good. Bagley looked like he belonged. He does look extremely good. Not completely fluid within the offense, breaking off some plays for himself, which is, I don't know, when you're going to be the kind of caliber player that we hope he will be, he will probably be doing that. I don't know. I just like Bielitsa in the starting lineup, and I think maybe it'll get to him and Bielitsa next season being the starting front court because he can do a, you know, Bagley can do a lot of stuff that Willie Cauley-Stein can do. He'd probably do it just as well and be a little more engaged with it. There were times last night that Willie was just – and the thing I realized with Willie, and we'd bring him up far too much, but I want to make this quick point here before I go back to Bagley. In pick and rolls, like, he won't stunt. Like, he'll just, nah, I'm going to go ahead and go who's the person that dribbles? The dribbler, the ball handler in the pick and roll, as opposed to trying to stunt between the ball handler and the roller, which immediately puts, I mean, it means that the guy on the other end is got to rotate. If he doesn't rotate, the play is messed up defensively. You're screwed. And far too often for the Sacramento Kings, that rotation doesn't come. I would prefer him stunts a little bit, show a little bit more resistance there. Bagley, it seems to me, has that level of interest in doing something like that. He's got a high activity level. The off the bounce is good. I thought he looked extremely good. People are making a lot about the stat line on Twitter. Regardless, he looked good to me. Looked like a complete player in the NBA. I didn't see anything otherworldly from him. Was there something that I should have seen in particular that you caught?
Well, I mean, anytime a rookie has 20 and 10, that's, I guess, okay. I'm not going to say he had a bad game, but what I will say is the fear with Bagley coming out of the draft was that he would be a 20 and 10 guy that didn't really have as much of an impact as 20 and 10 makes it sound. And a lot of the reasons to see that last night were he had one assist and two turnovers, and he did get 22 points, but it took him 20 shots, only took two free throws, missed both the threes he took. It's a little bit of an empty stat line, which for any rookie to get 20 and 10, that's impressive. And I'm not criticizing him for that, but I think that's the reason I want to see him in the starting lineup, because when he's on the bench, they can just feed him and see, all right, can you score? And can you just score for us and get us back to the starters? And then we'll go back to playing our type of basketball. But if he's playing with that starting lineup, he's going to need to actually actively make decisions that helps De'Aaron Fox, which means setting good screens, rolling to the basket, even with the understanding that sometimes you're not going to get the lob attempt. Getting out of the post so you can get out of people's way and just spacing out to the corner, even though most of the times you do that, you're not going to get the ball. And when you do get the ball, sometimes kicking it out to someone else. And it also means when he does get the ball in the post, he needs to look for people, which he missed quite a few open shooters and took, you know, bad 5 foot half hooks or whatever that he missed multiple times against the Raptors. And he's just going to have to learn not to do that. And I think the best way to learn not to do that is to put him up there with the starters and say, hey, you need to understand how to fit in with these people that are actually already really good and are winning. You need to know how to get out of their way, and you also need to know how to help them. And I think that's what the starting lineup does for him. And I think last night's game, as good as it is, he's going to need to learn not to do a lot of the things he did.
That's funny. I did not notice him missing shooters on the perimeter for poor attempts at half hooks.
I'll send them to you.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I look forward to it. Seemed to me like when he was in the post, he was doing what he should have done, and he was getting good looks. And maybe a couple of them didn't go down, but everything looked in the flow to me when he was working out of the pivot.
Well, I'll also say Giles had the same problem. I mean, he got triple teamed at one point.
Giles for sure has a problem in the post. Well, actually, he can pass out of the post, but the whole when to go, when to pass, judging when that the trap guy is coming. What?
He makes the decision, like he gets the ball and decides, I'm going to hit a cutter.
Yeah.
And then just waits for someone to cut. And even if they're not open, he's going to get it to them.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. He's kind of making that decision beforehand, which is tough.
Yeah.
I think that's all we got for those two games. Not a whole lot to remember. Maybe just watch them, flush them down the toilet after you listen to this podcast, and then move on to hopefully some more fruitful games for the Sacramento Kings to come. With the All-Star game on the horizon, it means the time of the trade deadline is upon us. We went over some of this on the last podcast, but there is more to discuss. I believe the trade deadline is it's like a week before the All-Star game. Okay, there you go. Good thing John's here. It's a February 7th. And with today being January 23rd, we are going to take, I guess, is this going to be our last deep dive into possible stuff where we think the Kings should target in trade scenarios?
Well, I mean, until we get some sort of substantial rumor or something actually happening, I don't know how much more we have. But I also think there will be more substantial rumors that are worth talking about. So who knows?
Okay. Do you want to go with your? Let's go with your stuff first, because you know what you're talking about more than me.
All right, sure. So I'll start with the guy that I know I'm not going to talk about, Troy Brown. And this is just a continuation of last week, right? Like, who's interesting?
Young guy,
as targets.
Young guy. He got drafted this year, not playing a whole lot for Washington. They're clearly in win now mode. He's middle of the draft. I think he was like 15th player that the Kings could target. 6'7", got the kind of size the Kings are looking for. Yeah, and a team that is desperate to find more talent that can help them win today.
Well, and I don't even know as much about the talent as, like you said, if they're not willing to deal out of Porter and Tank, or, you know, whatever crazy thing they're saying right now, they also don't have anything to trade to get better other than Troy Brown. And beyond that, they also need to get rid of salary. And so if they're not doing that through their three good players, they're going to have to do it through Jan Mahinmi. And the Kings can obviously take on that deal. Troy Brown makes sense. I think that would be a desperate trade on their part, but they're kind of saying desperate things. So those are the teams you take advantage of.
Vlade Divac continuing his reign of terror against Eastern Conference GMs not named Sam Hinkie.
Yeah. Sure. I mean, if we're going to call the Bruno Caboclo trade and the getting Iman Shumpert his reign of terror, then...
Well, he saved $10 million on the Iman Shumpert trade. The Bruno Caboclo trip.
I can't emphasize that enough.
Oh, well, oh, that he spent, wait, whatever. You got to spend it some sort of way. It doesn't work out. Yeah. He doesn't work out. He was able to salvage it. And the Bruno Caboclo trade, you take your chances. There was a player that you had, you weren't very high on. You trade him for another guy to get a good look at him. That's whatever. I was more referring to the trade for the draft pick that eventually became Malachi Richardson when he exchanged Marco Bellinelli with the Charlotte Hornets. Rich Cho, no longer a GM. There you go.
That was, honestly, I'll never forget that coming through and thinking, I read this wrong. They typed it wrong. They have a bad source. I don't know how this could have happened.
Wait, but, are the Charlotte Hornets still in the NBA? Oh, wait, they are. Okay, all right.
Yeah. Thank goodness we used it well.
Troy Brown, but, number... Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, yeah, anyway. I was just going to say, next one.
Yeah, that... Oh, me too. Good thing we're on the same wavelength here. Number two.
All right, so I'll go with one that... Dario Saric, I don't know that they can trade for him because I don't know what they could get Minnesota that Minnesota would really want. Like, there's not really an obvious salary dump. Willie Cauley-Stein's really the only arguably talented player that they would be willing to give up. And that doesn't make sense with them having Karl Anthony Towns there. So, yeah, I don't know. I don't know how they do it now, but he's a restricted free agent pretty soon. I don't know how badly they want to keep him. And as you and I were discussing, Bielitz is a good fit for this team. Unfortunately, he's a little bit too old to really be a super long-term piece. And so getting sort of the younger Bielitz, who I would say is also better, you know, makes sense at some point. I don't know how they do it. It's probably not at this deadline, but it's a guy just to keep an eye on.
I like Dario Saric. I like his age. I like his size. I like his shooting ability. All things that would be of use to the Sacramento Kings. And like you say, he would fit in perfectly with the age curve that a lot of these young players of the Sacramento Kings are on. That being said, Bielitz is not terribly old, and he's already affordable. He's only going to get more affordable, most likely. Yeah, I just, with this one, I don't see any easy, I don't know. I'd find it really difficult for the Timberwolves to part with Dario Saric. There is a contract on their books that they're not thrilled with in Gordie Jang, well, but I don't think their appetite to get rid of that contract is high enough to give up promising young piece like Saric.
Yeah, I don't either. And it really just, I don't know. It's going to be tough. I agree with you. But that is the thing with these guys. Like Saric, I just highly doubt gets a max offer when he's a restricted free agent. And so in that sense, there's a lot of wiggle room to pay him something that isn't the max, that also isn't what Minnesota's going to match. And we'll just see. Maybe there's a trade. Maybe there's not. Got to keep your eye on. He would be a good fit.
Like, if he gets a big number from the Kings, I would trust it. Because as we've stated, at least I've stated on this podcast a couple times, if there's one thing we can nail down, it's European prospects. We have the intel.
I mean, it's always worth reminding people, as great as I think Bagley and Giles are, we absolutely thought a couple years ago that Cauley-Stein and Scow are probably the front court of the future. So, you never know which one of those will work out and exactly how much they'll work out. And maybe there's some room for a really great power forward in the future. Maybe he could still work off the bench. Who knows? But, yeah, keep your eye on him.
Number three.
I think, yeah. Josh Jackson.
Interesting. Another team where I don't believe the appetite is high enough. Because if they're giving up the young player, they want an impact player right away, and I'm not sure that the Kings have somebody of that caliber, in at least in their eyes. And I was going to bring this up later on, but I'll just bring it up now. I don't think there is a trade outside of the Washington trade that we talked about earlier with Mahimi and Troy Brown that the Kings could do straight up. I think it would have to be a three-teamer like the one that Richard from Sacktown Royalty had up on Twitter yesterday,
yeah,
where it involves three teams and the Kings are giving up the matching money and they're getting back the young piece. Some other team is getting the player that they need for their particular need, and then they are giving up the first round draft pick to do that. I think it's going to take multiple teams if the Kings are going to be doing something at the trade deadline. I don't see enough motivation from the Kings and another team straight up to get something done. Which player were we talking about? I completely Josh Jackson. That's right. So yeah. Phoenix Suns. How motivated are they going to be to get rid of him? I guess he is a little redundant with Mikal Bridges.
Extremely redundant because
playing
Mikal Bridges though.
He's playing well, and then T.J. Warren is playing extremely well. And then the other side of that is, well, what do we talk about?
Oubre.
Well, and Kelly Oubre, what do we talk about on this podcast all the time? At least I've mentioned it on Twitter with a couple people, Touchdown Al in particular, that when you have wing, you need as many wings as humanly possible. That's just the name of the game now in the NBA. They could conceivably run lineups out there where they have five wings. And if any one of those players goes down, all of a sudden they're going to need that other guy. It's this constant balancing act between, oh, we've got too many guys, but wait, we need all those guys because wings are at such a premium in the NBA versus, oh man, one guy went down, man, we're now weak at that position. Balancing that is so tough, but it seems like when they've got, So what was the other guy that you mentioned beyond T.J. Warren and Mikal Bridges?
Kelly Oubre, who they do seem to like. And, yeah, I mean, I don't disagree with you here. The one thing I will say, though, is that Josh Jackson was drafted by a different GM and just hasn't done that well. And sometimes we see those guys undervalued. So you're right about the three-team thing. This is going to need to be a three-teamer. But who knows?
Who's that other team? Like, because now you need a team that wants to get off money. So now you Memphis, you're talking about Memphis. Memphis is going to, I don't know what Memphis wants back in return, but you're doing Memphis a huge favor if you're taking one of their big contracts away from them. So you don't need to throw them a ton, but you've also got to give something back to Phoenix. I'm guessing they're going to want young player pick, something along those lines. Memphis is already out their pick probably this year to Boston. Sacramento's already out their pick, which just hamstrings the ability of both those teams to kind of do something. So on that front, it would be difficult.
I can't really see it in my head at this point, but I think there's something around Dennis Smith Jr. I think that could be the eventual the three-team thing. I just don't see what the third team is sending.
Yeah, but Dallas would want Josh Jackson, so he wouldn't be making his way to Sacramento.
Yeah, but Josh Jackson's not nearly enough for Dennis Smith Jr.
Well, no, I think that makes sense straight up for both teams. Like, you throw in one thing here or there, but neither of those guys has performed very well. I don't know what leg either team would have to stand on in terms of asking for more.
You're right. I do think I would say Phoenix could ask for a little more. One thing to remember there is I would argue that Dennis Smith has been quite a bit better than Josh Jackson so far, but I would also say that Dallas is in the much more, for the reasons you pointed out about wing depth is not a problem in the NBA right now. So,
oh, it is. Wait, wing depth isn't a problem.
It's not a problem to have, like,
oh, gotcha.
Like, you can't have too many wings, really, is what I mean to say. And, you know, Dallas does seem to be not doing well with Dennis Smith in terms of just their relationship with him. So, I think they're just for that reason, you could be right that it may be a straight up swap or close to that just because Phoenix can sit there and say, we're not throwing anything else in. We don't need to get rid of Josh Jackson.
Josh Jackson seems like he would be a good fit next to Luka. Then again, I think most everyone in the league would be a good fit next to Luka.
Yeah, anyone who plays hard and can switch positions is probably a good fit next to him. Although he does need to learn to shoot.
Number four on the list of John Schifferle. Oh no, right. I know who this is. Cool. We're finally getting to this. For everyone who listened until this point, good for you, because you're about to get an interesting conversation.
Yeah, this take has been too hot for me to really let out.
Oh, we've talked about this before.
Yeah, I tried to keep it under wraps because I don't want people to understand just how badly I want it to happen.
Well, you've done a poor job of that because we've discussed it.
Oh, I know. All right, so it's Markelle Fultz, which it's hard to explain. We were talking the other day, maybe on, maybe not on the podcast, about, so my proposed trade centers around Bielitsa because they desperately need a stretch four next to Embiid. We know that Embiid likes to play with stretch fours, and we know that they tried to sign Bielitsa, which means they must like him to some degree. And he's on a longer-term deal, and like you said, could be at around his current talent level for a few more years. So you could feel good about adding that type of cheap bench depth for multiple seasons that fits well with what you need and is cost-controlled, so you can sign people like Jimmy Butler and Ben Simmons. So I think he makes sense, and I think Shumpert makes sense because they need wing bodies that can shoot threes and play hard defensively. And that's what Iman Shumpert does. He has positional flexibility, which with them is really important and costs a little bit of money. So how do they make that salary work? They can send us Markelle Fultz. And I can't believe that there was even a part of my brain that thought, no, I don't know about giving up Shumpert like that. No. I would absolutely give up both of them. I can't believe I questioned that. So what are your thoughts on that swap?
I know half, maybe a third, maybe a quarter of what you know about Markelle Fultz. You also goosed this discussion by sending me a Markelle Fultz Draft Express strength video right before we hopped on the podcast, which I was listening right before we started recording. He is of the kind of size and skill profile that the Kings could use. Another ball handler, creator, can't have too many of those. Right kind of size, 6'5", 6'6". Shoots really well if his shoulder doesn't have some sort of voodoo disease or voodoo syndrome going on with it. A player that is skilled out of the pick and roll, skilled getting to the basket, lots of upside. There's a reason why he was drafted number one by the Philadelphia 76ers. I look at this, I say, yes, is he more talented than Bielitsa and Shumpert? I would say most definitely. And it wouldn't take too long to get another unit up to speed as far as being your primary go-to five in crunch time scenarios starting the game, which is the only reason that would preclude me from including Bielitsa in a deal, despite how much it would hurt me because I love him so much. This is the kind of swing you have to take when you're looking for talent, when you're building, when you want to take shots that are calculated, where the risk is moderate, but you're still taking a chance. I think the Kings do it if they get the chance to trade for him. My question is whether Philly is ready to cut the cord. I think they want to hold on to this guy. They realize how good he is. They're the ones that drafted him. The people who are running that team are the ones who were in the organization when the draft pick was made.
Well,
yeah. Oh, yeah. All those. Alton Brand was still with the franchise. At least he was in the front office when that pick was made, if I understand correctly. That leads me to believe that they're going to want to hold on to him as long as possible. They're going to definitely play out this season. So getting him at the trade deadline would be tough. If you could convince them and they feel like they need to make some sort of move to escalate their chances of winning immediately, because immediacy and urgency definitely drives deals like deadlines do, then maybe they could get something done. Yes, I would be in favor of getting Markelle Fultz. That's kind of the long and the short of my opinion on it.
Well, the tough thing with him is, despite being on a rookie deal, he's still making like $10 million a season. And they have to make a decision pretty soon on his option, which honestly, they may not pick up for that fourth year. I don't know when they have to make that decision. I don't usually pay that much attention to that stuff. But that's tough for a rookie that's not doing anything for you. And then you add that on to the fact that they do have Zaire Smith that they just drafted. What was it, like 16th overall, which he's thought to be a pretty high upside guy. They have Landry Shamet, who has played really well for them this year and looks like a great pick at, I believe, 26. And then they have that nice Miami pick, and I believe all of their picks going forward. So they're not hurting for young talent outside of their core right now, which is already, outside of Jimmy Butler, still very young. And
they have a chance to win the lottery this year, by the way.
Oh, yeah, with the Kings.
So, good point. Got to remind everybody about that. Got to stick the knife just a little bit further in. Just twist it. Just, okay.
Yeah, some incredible odds could land them Zion. There's that non-zero chance.
Oh, wait, and, unless the Kings make the playoffs, in which case that's over with.
Yeah, then it will be a zero chance. But I don't know. I mean, I would make that deal. I think Philadelphia does ask for more, like you said. But I think a lot of it is, all right, if you're Philadelphia, you say, we're clearing salary, we're getting two guys that can help us this year. And the minute we traded for Jimmy Butler, we put ourselves on the clock, because he is relatively old. And
he's so old at 28. Oh, that old man, Jimmy Butler.
Well, and you have to remember, he has an incredible number of miles on him and gets hurt all the time. And I would say, I mean, at this point, it's not necessarily that he's so old and maybe you only have a two-year window. I'm not really saying that. I'm saying your window is maybe 5 to 6 years with this core. And assuming you get – I mean, we're just talking basic probability here. Assuming you get to the finals all six of those years, and it's 6 years long, you're going to win three of them around there. That's assuming you can get there six straight times. And, you know, guys like LeBron James can tell you that those odds don't always work out in your favor. Sometimes it's much less than that. So they just don't have many cracks at it. They need to get to the finals every time they can. They need to make every season with this three-person core meaningful, and I think that means they need to add bench depth and even try to get off some money so they can sign someone in the offseason. And so I think if they got the right deal, they could do that. I don't know if that's quite enough for them. I don't blame them if it's not. But I would throw in Willie Cauley-Stein too, honestly.
I
wouldn't even think about it.
I love being on the other side of a trade where the team is desperate to increase their chances of winning by like 2%. I'll take the other side of that trade all day long, every day.
And, I mean, just a question for anyone out there that's ever seen Elfrid Payton play basketball, who, by the way, cannot shoot either. Markelle Fultz today, if we just got rid of the shoulder issue, got rid of any time when he ever, it seemed like he could shoot, and we just said, he's just not a good shooter. He makes like 50% of his free throws and, you know, 10 to 15% of his threes. He just can't do it. Guys like that have been taken in the lottery recently. I mean, he is still talented, and he's way more talented than Elfrid Payton is, even without the jumper. So he really just needs to get to a point where his shoulder's not hurting him anymore. And just going back in time to a moment that everyone makes fun of is when supposedly Golden State traded for Bogut. They gave the Bucks the option of, you can have Monte Ellis or Steph Curry. And I want to say it was reported recently that they actually, the Steph Curry trade was kind of waved off for medical reasons with his ankle. And imagine at that time, I think it sounded reasonable to say, we don't know what's going to happen with Steph Curry's ankle. We're going to go with Monte Ellis. But that's a perfect example why so many teams that make it to the finals do so because they took a massive risk with lots of upside that really worked. Or they just had a unbelievable something happen to them. Like Cleveland having LeBron James happen to be there. And they just happened to get the first overall pick the year that this kid that's one of the most talented players to ever play graduates from high school in the same area. You know, like that type of stuff happens, and that's what gets teams to the finals. Similarly, Steph Curry having this ankle problem that seems unsolvable and then magically just kind of solving it one day. So I wouldn't give up a lot for Fultz necessarily. I wouldn't be even entertaining like Buddy Hield, Bogey, De'Aaron Fox, anything like that. But the fact is, that could be the type of trade where you look back and say, I can't believe we even talked about Shumpert and Bielitsa for Fultz. Like, how is that a discussion at all? And you can say, oh, well, his shoulder hurt him. And it's going to sound stupid in a couple of years. It also may not. It may not work out, but I just think those are the risks you take, especially when it's frankly important to keep in mind that we are behind the eight ball by not having this pick, because even though it's not a high lottery pick like Kings fans are used to, it's still probably going to end up being like 12, which is a good pick to have in any draft. So
I've been wanting to say this. Actually, I don't want to end the podcast on it. I'll say it another day. Doesn't need to be said today. We'll end on that beautiful monologue that you gave us.
Oh, well, thank you. I rehearsed it just for that.
He is John Schifferle. You can find him on Twitter at John Schifferle. You can find me on Twitter at my buddy Chris. For all of HoopBall's Sacramento Kings coverage on Twitter, it's at HoopBall Kings. And for all of your NBA news, NBA fantasy news, and Sacramento Kings coverage, period, it's hoop-ball.com. Get the season pass now if you're playing fantasy basketball. It is a must-have. If you're a new user to DraftKings and deposit $10 there, it gets you access to the season pass for free. The draft, the daily, I think it's like a weekly fantasy contest.
It is weekly.
It's weekly. The Dan Besbris. Yeah, go follow Dan, at Dan Besbris, right? Is that his handle? I can't remember now.
I'll be looking it up.
Please look it up. While you do that, I'll mention that we are now sponsored, HoopBall is sponsored, by Hawaiian Isles Kona Coffee Company, hawaiianisles.com. Or search Hawaiian Isles Kona Coffee on Amazon to get some of their fine product, some of their very full product, according to John Schifferle. It is very good coffee, and you should pick some up when you get the chance. And on Twitter, you can follow them at HI Kona Coffee. Also, if you play in one of those contests, you want to try some of this coffee. It's only $3 to enter, and coffee is one of the prizes, along with t-shirts and I think $15. So where else can you win $15 and some extremely good coffee? I don't know of another place. John? No. Besbris's handle?
Yeah, it's at Dan Besbris. You were right.
Follow Dan. He is constantly putting out those details, especially weekly. Be sure to check that out on Wednesdays. Today is Wednesday, so be sure to check it out next Wednesday. You can find this show on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, Google Play, as well as the iHeartRadio and HoopBall Radio apps, which are available for free to download in the iTunes and Google Play stores. For John Schifferle, I'm Christian Villere. See you next time.
This has been a HoopBall presentation.